Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's episode of the new show, Oracles of Theleston. Today's episode, episode one, Rise of the Oracles, is in fact quite appropriate, as this is the, once again, the rise of the new show. And we have some awesome folks. If you ever watched the Revival Cast show that we used to have, same time, same channel, about 6 months ago, then you probably recognize Diggs, Zero, and Polaris here, who are three of the regulars from that. And I'm going to start making myself a regular here, too. So, yeah. So, welcome, everybody. And thank you all very much for coming, everybody in chat. The three of you here, I really appreciate having you all here this weekend. And we're just going to kind of go around clockwise real quick and give everyone a chance to kind of introduce themselves and kind of talk about a little bit of your involvement before we start getting into the main subjects here. So let's start with you, Polaris.
Oh, hi, everybody. It's been almost, 5 months since the last Revival Cast. I've been around since January of 2015, and I'm still around being a pain in the ass and participating wherever they'll have me. I'm excited.
Very cool.
Which is cool that we can keep the excitement up. There's still development going on for Theleston. It's just not Revival. I'm Diggs, and really, really, really loving the world building that's going on for Theleston. And hopefully we will have enough projects out at some point that we'll be able to revive Revival.
Absolutely, yeah. Hey, wait a minute there, Diggs. and Zero, how about you?
Well, I'm Zero. You may have heard me as Dick Millionaire. Either's appropriate. Just kidding. I've been excited for this. It's been a lot of fun kind of seeing Theleston evolve as an IP, even though it really does, you know, kind of suck how Revival as a meow failed out, it's been really great seeing everyone kind of help pick it up, and mostly I just kind of hang around throwing inane comments in, so generally useless, but that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And
just I tell my Theleston shirt.
Oh
though.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, good job.
Rocking that. We got the shirts they had a Teespring a month or so ago, almost 2 months ago, I think. And yeah, these amazing shirts, exclusive. They might run it again sometime in the future, but don't plan on it. So if you didn't get in on that run, tough noogies, wait for the next exclusive Teespring shirt run to go on. So,
well, is it going to be T-Fall, T-Winter, T-Fall? It's got to be T-Fall.
That makes sense. So, yeah, so I've been around a little bit with the community here. Kind of got interested, obviously, when the Theory of Forge guys got me interested in Revival, and it's just been really, really exciting for me to see, you know, what's been going on with it. And, you know, we kind of know, and I'm just going to kind of give the breakdown here in just a moment of, you know, how things happen. But before that, just really what we're going to be doing here, what this show is about, is really covering everything about this new direction for Theleston. Now that it is in the hands of Skyward Star Corporation, they you know, they have full access, the full IP and everything. So there's no contingency, no hiccup. It's just been able to be picked up and continued. And it just so happens that the amazing talent over there recognizes the awesome ability to leverage the community of willing and awesome people to help make this world of Theleston come alive just as they would have wanted to see, though in really amazing different ways. Oh yeah, and I'm Team Carrie on the Joint Knights.
No word of a lie.
So that's kind of what the show is about here. Now let's kind of talk about the fall of Revival. And it's kind of an odd story. It's kind of a, I wouldn't say a sad story because it has a nice end to it. But basically what happened was Elphonic at some point looked around their company, assessed the resources they had, and realized, crap, we're not going to be able to make Revival. This is just not going to happen for us. And, you know, normally when you hear something like that, everybody is just permanent facepalm pose like a statue because, you know, something that could have been amazing didn't happen. But that's not the case here. Due to having been kind of the one spearheading, I believe, the inventors of the IP, if I'm not mistaken, Ombaugh and Snipe were able to negotiate to actually get 100% of the IP for Revival and all things Theleston brought over to the ownership of Skyward Star Corporation, which means they've been able to continue, not only have they been able to continue, but actually leverage all the assets and content for the most part that had been developed under Illphonic's watch. So it's a really good place to start for something that's essentially, you know, super small dev team plus fan project, you know, community outreach, community interaction sort of thing. So what we've actually been able to do from there has just been amazing. So just on the subject of the kind of end of Revival, let's just kind of go around a little, I'm going to go clockwise again here, kind of, you know, what your thoughts were when you heard about it, that it was going down the way it was, and, you know, how things kind of went from there. And again, Polaris, I'll have you start us off.
I'm kind of sticking my mind back there at the time. I think we kind of covered it in a way on our last Revival cast on March 6th. But we had seen a couple of odd things, and yet with everybody else, when the word came down and how strange it was that Snipe was the one who was tasked with writing this post to all of the community saying Illphonic is done, rather than having Illphonic do that particular task. And then the confusion and stuff like that. It was a very odd time. It was very disappointing. I think a lot of folks felt like the rug had been kind of yanked out from underneath us, and we were a bit adrift. Fortunately, I didn't leave or go anywhere, and so in very short order, we went to Plan B.
Absolutely. And that Plan B is quite exciting. Yes. And, you know, that's the thing it's so uncanny that it happened at almost the exact same time that EverQuest Next got canned. They were, you know, within a few weeks of each other.
Yeah.
And that, you know, it was a very foreboding sign. Like, wow, these two games that were setting out to be the absolute future of the MMO format as we see it and know it, it, you know, it's just so jarring that they just both went down like that. Though, I think, you know, with the success of Chronicles of Illyria and how well they did with their Kickstarter and where that's going, I think the dream is still alive and a lot of people still want to do it, which is something that's been exciting to me, because I figured everybody was going to be gun-shy about trying to move forward with the genre and forward with the style and the use of the technology, but clearly people have been uninhibited. They just want to keep going forward and, you know, move forward with the style, move forward with, you know, the future of games as we know and play them.
Well, I have a more cynical view than that, because it's not that they, you know, heard that these two games folded and were like, well, I'm going to start my own. No, they were already working on that, and they're too far gone to stop. So I don't have any optimism that they're going to finish. I have no optimism that they're going to finish or that it's going to be any good. I'm watching them continue, but I'm not expecting any of these games to... I mean, I was saying with Landmark that they need to, or Daybreak, that they need to show and not tell. And at this point, yeah, I'm skeptical of everything at this point. I So yeah, they're going to continue and give it a shot. But and especially, I think that the feature that I'm most, I guess, disappointed at not seeing fruition is the story brick slash tagging style system for AI. I think that's the feature that I feel needs to be implemented to really bring MMO, MRPGs to the next level. But we've got Theleston and we've got some other projects. So I love the world building of Theleston, aside from the game. So I'm glad that that portion is still alive. And I wonder what I can say about my disappointment, because it sounds like I perceive, or I feel that Revival is on hiatus rather than dead. Yeah. So
yeah, that's a good way to do it.
Yeah,
I only see it as Revival if it is Skyward Star and Elphonic's collaboration. If not, I don't see it as Revival. I see it as a different project. Just because I guess I associate Revival with Illphonic at this point, that I kind of tied the two together. And then that whole stipulation that should the game be developed in some sort of digital multiplayer online format, Illphonic gets to be one of the first on the list to be assessed for joining and continuing the development. So, you know, they may still get involved again later down the road.
Well, Revival is the specific design for that specific RPG.
That's true.
Who's doing the coding? I mean, I don't. Or helping with the production of it. I mean, Skyward has to be integral because they're the stewards. I mean, that's where Theleston lives, is in their brains. But who's helping them with that? You know, it's really making that specific game design come to fruition. I don't think the developer who's helping with them that necessarily matters. But.
Fair enough. All right, Zero, we've left you hanging here. What you got?
I'll never hang. You know, it was frustrating. I kind of came into Revival later than a lot of people did. You know, kind of Lake or Phelan Blight, you know, as she's also known as, was the one who introduced it to me. She was looking around, and I remember vaguely seeing it once before, but I hadn't paid much attention. But I was expressing to her my frustration with the current crop of MMOs. We were playing Arcade, and I don't know. There's just a lot of, you know, ennui about the whole genre. And so she was like, well, check this out. And I did. And I was like, wow. And I bought into that in such a big way. Literally, I mean, I bought a man's, like, I don't know, 3 hours later. and so it was really disappointing, obviously, to hear it kind of be put on hold, hiatus, whatever you want to call it. I mean, ultimately, it's just, it wasn't happening as it was planned. On one hand, though, I kind of felt I always got what I really wanted out of it. I mean, I technically got my house, my property. I can enter it. Yes, maybe it's not super interactable, but I got what I paid for there, and I got access to the Founders Chat, which really was the best part of that. You know, for months I got to hang out with people and see this world get built and see these awesome systems be kind of explained and developed. So the potential was just really there. With it being shuttered like that, had I been on the outside of that, had I not, honestly, had I not utilized those founder perks, you know, and just kind of, oh, about my property, I'm off on the side, I don't really care, I'll just wait for the news updates, I probably would have been a lot more frustrated. When you see it from the inside, there's no denying the, you know, the passion that the developers have for it, that Skyward had for this, and you know, in Illphonic as well. So it ultimately, just kind of said this before, but ultimately just came down to, as soon as they announced, I saw the announcement was from Snipe, there's never any follow-up from Illphonic really on it. That bothered me, but at the same time they said, hey, we kind of have, you know, some chances here, you know, and right to the, you know, intellectual property, and as they kind of explain their thought process going forward and trying to continue on with it, it was good enough for me. I mean, I could sit there and you know, basically sit and bitch about, you know, what I've lost, or just, you know, embrace what really mattered to me, which was the world, the story, the lore, and the systems. And if there's any way for those to continue, then, you know, I'm going to try to help see it continue. That was said, it's a long road, and I think people need to be really cognizant of that. Everything points back to the meow, and I think everyone wants that. And I know a lot of people have said on the Outliers, you know, have been like, you know, I only really care about the game, I don't care about anything else. And that's fine, I understand that.
But they only care about the meow?
Yeah. You know, there's a lot of people who have that opinion. It's like, I love the world, but I want the game, I don't care about anything else. It's been said, it's been on the forums, as people were leaving Discord or IRC, you know. And I can understand that sentiment. But at the same time, if you want to see it, because it is still a possibility, then you have to, you know, be willing to, you know, support and help where you can. And that varies from level to level. I'm not a programmer. I'm learning some coding because I just wanted to. And I'm not an artist. I can draw some freaking bomb stick figures, but that's it. I've elevated stick figures to about as far as I can go.
Nice. Well, you can do a lot with stick figures. Right. And I think, you know, you mentioned something there, and I actually kind of want to, I'm excited to see the inverse. People who are so invested and so big on the pen and paper side of things that they don't even care that there's going to be a digital game. They're like, yeah,
right,
whatever. Like, I got my crew. We play every Sunday together, you know, whatever. You know.
Yeah, and so that's really cool. I mean, you know, the PNP started, and I like PNPs. I have not had time to really play them in a good while. Good long while, but I'm still excited to see it happen and to see which I'm sure we'll dive into more detail in the next couple minutes here, but to see some of the things coming back, like the Origin Matrix is still being developed, you know, and to see these pieces kind of continue to be developed and that'll be usable in the future. That's all good stuff. I mean, I think, I guess, you know, it's like, how can I not want to be involved with further development at some level, because it's a worthwhile world and story, and I mean, huh, it's a great journey.
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, because I'm not really a gamer, I game because I'm into role playing, and world building and storytelling, and one of the things that inspired me about Revival Game is that it really, even just with the interactive maps that we had on the site, I could already feel invested and immersed in the world. Well, I have to say the maps in conjunction with the weekly dev blogs that were giving us little tastes of characters within the world.
Yeah, the day in the life and the stories and stuff, really, yeah. That shared so much of, you know, what the world is, and, you know, really get you into it.
Right, and so
the imagination.
Yeah,
and so what I love about D&D is not just the tabletop game, or I like the tabletop game, I like the novels, I like playing through. There was a Facebook game a few years ago. I played that. You know, there's all kinds of different ways to experience the world that I enjoyed because, you know, I'm invested in the world, and that's the beauty of the continuing development of Theleston, is that we can still have the storytelling and be immersed in the world, and then how we interact with the world can take a variety of different paths. Hopefully we'll get the meow, but, you know, I wouldn't mind having a game on mobile or some novellas from Amazon.
But yeah, no, it's true. I mean, the world exists forever. You know, games are going to come and go. No matter how awesome it might have been, eventually it moves on. But the world is always going to be there. And if you make a good world, it'll last a long time. I mean, just look at, you know, like D&D.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we kind of talked about the end of things. Now we also talked a little bit about some of the new things. What's been on the rise? What's been good? And I think that's the thing to really focus on here. Is after things went down the way they did, and the IP was transferred over to Skyward Star in full, that that really opened the door to all the new projects and all the stuff that's going on. Because before, sure, we could have, worked together and made some of these other projects, or, try to do them as a community, but it wouldn't have had, the focus and attention of the original minds of the project, and we wouldn't have nearly the amount of guidance and support we would need to be able to even do this stuff. Meanwhile, it was also the contingency that everything would have been, because Revival used to be an Ilphonic project, anything that we would have done, I think Ilphonic would have had their hands in, or would have needed to approve one way or another. So this completely gets us out of that and really opens up a completely different situation where instead we can actually work with them on really any number of projects, and for better or for worse, the lack of a budget means we're not tied down by the purse strings. Whatever people are willing to contribute, whatever time and effort, and whatever projects people want to do, that's awesome. That's all added value and added content for the overall the world and the brand and everything. So it's something that we couldn't have even done doing the fan projects and stuff before, until this transfer had happened, and it became Skyward Star's 100% IP and all of that sort of stuff. So there is definitely that, you can call it a blessing in disguise, or you could call it kind of shedding off the corporate baggage is something that just wasn't going to work, unfortunately, and being able to come out with a new face, a new look, scuttling out of I think of a hermit crab, like scuttling out of a tin can that it just grew out of into basically this giant, amazing whatever it is that has infinite potential, and they can just keep on growing for the rest of their days. Like that's what I feel like the changeover really did for the project. Just opened up all the possibilities and lets it live on and keep growing in just the most amazing ways. And if it gets so big that it has to scuttle out of that shell and find something else, my goodness, like that'll be a good time to see. So, that being said, I'm going to kind of kick it around the opposite way this time, and we're going to kind of talk about just a little bit of what we've actually been working on or been involved with a little bit since everything changed over. So, Zero, what sort of stuff have you been working with the team on at this point?
Like I said, I make a lot of inane comments. I offer very little in the way of... So Pen and Paper was the first thing that launched, and while I was super excited about that, I don't have a ton of experience DMing them, so it wasn't one that I felt I could really offer a lot of contribution to, other than making commentary on viewpoints as a player, which I think does matter, because it's not just the game creators that run around playing these things, right? So usually the average player who has to derive enjoyment from it and also be able to understand what they're doing. And if you take the lowest common denominator like me, then you're even better, because if I can get it, then surely anyone will be fine. So the pen and paper really has made a lot of progress, but shortly kind of after that, they had the divination cards, right? Don't know a dang thing about them. I know, very basic information. Nothing that can't be beaten by Wikipedia in, 5 seconds of reading. So, I've seen it. Sounds super cool, and I will absolutely queue up to get a copy of my own. No input on it, though. Dust in the wind. A little bit more recently, one of the members, Shadowwind, came out with the Hidden Object Adventure idea, and having played some of them in the past, but also just in general understanding those, have been pretty more involved with that, and that's been kind of fun because it's a little bit more simple and it's more story than trying to, you know, code and develop raw things from my perspective. I mean, obviously I can't do it anyways, but you know, that it's something that I conceptualize easier.
I can't conceptualize it at all, so I have no clue what the hidden object thingamabob is. Explain that to us, please.
So, you know, a hidden object game, there's an environment, there's a lot of story and text, limited inventory, or maybe it's not a limited inventory, but you'll have to go around and pick things up. I won't say King's Quest in particular, because I actually never played those specific games. Quest for Glory maybe was a little more action-y than, you know, that sort of thing. But I'm trying to think of, like, some of the early examples of, you know, that sort of game.
Mist and Riven were, you know, early examples of that genre, you know, being kind of explored to its fullest. You know, combat isn't a major thing. Interaction with other people isn't a major thing. It's usually the player and the world that they're interacting with, and solving various puzzles to continue on the story. And that genre has since, you know, gone from being, you know, what was games that came out like Mist, Riven, and a bunch of Sierra games came out with a bunch that I played too. And they were really long, involved games. And then they've also been, Shadowrun introduced this whole other ones, which are these more like 6 to 8 hour shorter games, lower cost things that are same idea though. You know, it's player in an interactive world. And as you work your way through the story, or I'm sorry, as you work your way through the puzzles, you're working your way through the story. And they tend to be a little bit easier to develop, from what I understand, because they're not a lot of animated sequences. It's mostly still images as you move through, which also gets to leverage a lot of assets we already have.
I've never heard this term before, which doesn't necessarily mean anything, but I've played Myst, mm-hmm. which is called a graphic adventure puzzle video game. Mm-hmm. Is what we're talking about a graphic adventure puzzle video game? And they just gave it a new label? Or probably. Is a hidden object different?
I would say hidden object's almost more of a subset of that. Go ahead.
Well, it's really interesting because the definitions that are sitting out there right now on Wikipedia and stuff like that are really kind of bad. So if you Google search on hidden object puzzle, you might have a dozen different examples of what the heck is that. Mm-hmm. But what we're talking about developing for Theleston is a hidden object puzzle adventure, which is where it adds the story, it adds some lore bits, it introduces the player to the entire world, the flavor of the world, the art assets we already have. So you have, in addition to hidden object puzzles, you have other kinds of puzzles as well. But it is probably just like the Mist overarching origination. It's a subset of that. But today, it's called Hidden Object Puzzle Adventure.
Okay. And so, based on what you said, and based on what I've already seen from the assets available in Revival, are we envisioning, how big of an area are we envisioning? Because I keep thinking we've got this, we've got this map for, what's the first? I haven't thought about
Crown's Rock.
Revival in so long. Yeah, for Crown's Rock. We've got the maps for that. So is the plan to focus on Crown's Rock for this? Or are we focusing on a larger area for this?
What's aimed to be Skypass.
So the first... Yeah, we're talking about creating a hidden object puzzle adventure. Acronym is HOPA. And, and we're looking at creating a series. So game one in the series will start in Skypass. Mm-hmm. Game two in the series, which is a continuation of one, will, I think, the way it's sitting right now, start in Crown's Rock. So we have the entire world to work with.
Yeah, isn't it more work to start with Skypass first?
Yes and no.
I would say yes and no, because you might have to create a lot more of the content and stories and cultures and customs and everything, but at the same time, you aren't tied down with all the stuff that we already know about Crown's Rock and have to, you know, work within what's already established. Not that Crown's Rock doesn't have a lot of stuff and isn't, like, just an absolutely dynamic place where you've got, you know, the worst of, you know, gutter slum poverty to some pretty nice stuff if you, you know, get to go in those nice neighborhoods.
And well, and I'm thinking we might be able to pull 2-3 games out of Crown's Rock within that series. Because we've got so much data and mapping and stuff already done.
Well, the nice thing is ultimately it's just that it is another project that introduces players to the world and has lore currently planned to be, you know, 100, 200 years before where the meow would take place. So there's a way to kind of build some world history into there and introduce players. It's almost an attempt to also kind of bring in another group of players, I think, you know, the ones
right. who play these
It's also a way to monetize easily.
Yeah, right, and that's, right. I think, a big one. It's just that
there are 2 million players of Hopas out there today, each one of them spending $15. It's a way to monetize the meow.
Right. Well, all of the projects are a way to monetize. Well, right. Supposedly. Well, but
They're all to monetize everything, though.
Yeah.
Right.
But it's been I've liked it mostly because it's been a very accessible project. You know, it's not hasn't required for a lot of people that have been able to participate. It hasn't required a huge in-depth knowledge of existing like PvP mechanics and where you need to be different with that or where you need to, you know, be similar. And it hasn't required any real dev work, actual programming or development work by a lot of the contributing members. So it's been a lot more kind of easy to jump into and provide assistance with, while the pen and paper is still kind of the priority. So there's kind of an established hierarchy of what's coming first, and the pen and paper really is the primary release. So that's unless, you know, things just really fall together and something becomes more, I guess, ideal to push like the Hope out first or the div cards out first, you know, whatever it is. I mean, I'm sure they're flexible about what's going to work best, but it's just been, it's nice because it's one that's been a lot more accessible as a project.
Yeah, I think honestly, for the divination cards, it's probably the art assets that are going to be the biggest holdup there,
yes.
Just because
yeah.
to have not only art assets for everything, but to have them be the amazing, beautiful assets that, you know, must be done to really match the quality of the world and, you know, everything that's being done here. It's not something where you can just go on DeviantArt and just pay any old schmo like, hey, you make stuff that I kind of like. Here's like $500 or, you know, a contract that says you'll get $500 when the project launches or whatever, and make all this art for us. Like, that's
right.
It's not quite how it works. It's, you know, it's a very, well, just finding an artist that you like and negotiating everything can be quite a tedious project, but, you know,
yeah.
taking that due diligence, you get what you know, really want in the end if you do everything right.
Art is the limiting factor for quite a few of the projects, actually, from my understanding. So if you happen to be watching this on YouTube, I don't think a lot of people are watching this currently on Twitch, but,
well,
you know, on
the
YouTube,
later too.
I'm just saying, you know, yeah. if our hundreds of viewers, thousands of viewers on YouTube happen to be an artist, you know, lots of the projects are looking for somebody who can do
something. Well, and I do think that with regard to the part of the reason that the HOPA project and the divination card project go hand in glove in places is because we're using the divination cards as a function, as a main mechanic in the HOPA for player to progress. So it's a way to bring in Theleston imagery, the whole divination card thing that a lot of players out on the Revival forums, they didn't even know it existed. You know, it was just there as a piece of magic for if you were going to roll a mage and get into divination as part of your skill set. I don't think folks knew that there was this whole divination card thing happening. Now we have the list of all 84 cards. We can actually build a deck. We can, and now we can have the cards as a standalone product, and then we can link them hand in glove to the HOPA and the PMP game. I mean, there's just a lot of potential for things to be stand alone as well as mix it up. And that part's what's exciting to me. Multiple use.
Did we talk about the divination cards yet?
No. I brought it up.
No, let's
segue.
Yeah, we definitely brought it up a bit. So the divination cards, first off, if you haven't already been, definitely the go follow the twitch.tv/DOP crew channel right now, because you should have already been following it. That's where Skyward Star does their things. We got the development streams on Thursday, and you know, other stuff comes up, and just, you know, getting to see them when they're not working and, you know, playing games and kind of getting to see a little bit more of their perspective on things. It's a really good sort of thing. But in particular, the reason why I bring it up is that they actually have the DOP crew bot, which has the divination card system linked up. You can actually get readings done. It's pretty cool. You can just go in while the bot's running, do exclamation reading, right?
Yep.
Exclamation reading. And then you'll have 25 of your tokens taken away. Should you have 25 tokens, you just get those from watching the channel. And the bot gives you a little reading. They draw 3 cards, put them down, and give you the results. So it's pretty cool. Oh, yeah, you must be following to actually earn the tokens. So yeah, it's definitely really nice to be able to see an actual functional version of the divination cards, and it's been kind of that way for a few months. They've had it working in the the bot for a little while. So, you know, just to be able to get an inkling of it and, you know, seeing what it can do, everything from being used as a gameplay element to somebody just, you know, being bored, you know, from point A to point B and like, all right, well, let me get a reading. Let me see what the cards have in store for me in the future here. And, you know, it's definitely kind of a fun sort of thing. For me, it usually just ends up being some work-related thing that, like, I kind of already knew. So it's been a little bit weird. Like, every single time in the past couple months that I've gotten a reading, it's been something work-related, so all right, you know, that's the thing you want to focus on, then divination cards do your thing. But yeah, divination cards, it's just a really awesome project, and it's this way to add a new set of flavor. Now, to kind of explain what they are, think of tarot cards, but more awesome and branded to the world of Theleston. That's pretty much the meat of it.
A good way to describe the basic concept.
Right.
There's definitely
so
a
if
lot
you have any familiarity with tarot cards, then you would have some familiarity with the divination card system and project.
And they're just fun in general, which is, you know, again, easily appealing.
Yeah.
Well, you know, when you think about the things that we saw off the Revival site for all the time that we were there, what were the things that got a lot of play, a lot of interest, and a lot of chatter? They were things like the Origin Matrix. What can it do? What do you mean it's the character creator? How does that work? What do you mean it's going to make me a story? Where, you know, and it's, so here we are getting a chance to see those kinds of primary mechanics being built. And for those of us who were interested in rolling a mage in Revival, watching the divination card system and project come to life this way, and then watching it being used on the Dope Crew channel via the bot, is a very exciting something coming to Earth and really landing. Because I can go play with that. I can give myself 10 readings if I feel like it, and if the others will accommodate my willingness to play around. You know? So that's the very cool thing, to see it like it's real. It's happening. This is a real thing. It's giving me a 3-card reading.
Yeah, that's for those cool of you watchers, viewers who are not able to see the playback chat, Snipe Hunter and Omboa were both saying that it's really important for the different products to be self-referential and weave in with one another so that there's not just one true version of Theleston. People don't think that, you know, this product is the true one and that, or that product is the true one. That's pretty important, yeah.
Yeah, and that's actually something that I gotta say, I knock a lot of properties and projects out there that, you know, they've got so many sequels and prequels and sidequels and whatever, and none of them link up whatsoever, have anything to do with the other ones. I can understand it with Final Fantasy. Each one is its own, like, instance or whatever, and unless they actually make a sequel off of that one, the next one you should expect to be different. But that's kind of been, you know, the history of that brand. That's not the same at all as, you know, I would imagine if I go through the entire Red Faction series, for example, there's a lot of opportunities they probably had to tie in the lore and the story and, you know, histories of families across the games, and just either didn't or weren't even thinking about it. So the fact that, you know, that's one of the other nice things, the fact that there's all these different projects in the works, and they actually occur at different times in the world, if I'm not mistaken, you know, it really makes for this interesting way to interweave everything. But because of the size of the world and because of the amount of stuff that goes on in it and the, you know, sorts of possibilities, because it is a world with, you know, physical gods that have physical influence, not, you know, expected gods that may or may not be the source of magic in the world, that, you know, all the stuff that's going on, there's so many things to tie it to all the other things, but there's also, you know, each project of its own, because of the richness of everything else, will be able to stand on its own. If that's the only game or product you play, it's going to be great. I would guess I would say the that's right, the Hopa, I believe, is 100 or 200 years in the past, though, you know, the progression of time, 100 years 200 years, it's hard to really, you know, wrap your head around that, considering, like, how long the winter in Crown's Rock was, for example, and, you know, how time seems to be, you know, dilated in different parts of the world in different ways. But, yeah, that's, I mean, all of that stuff is just really exciting. And the fact that, you know, further source books for the pen and paper, for example, could represent certain specific periods along the kind of general timeline of the world. There's a lot of stuff that probably has a lot of variance, but I would imagine there's probably going to be a few key specific events that will happen in every iteration of that universe that's depicted. So,
yeah. And on the PNP has its own card system too, if I recall. Nero, you've been really involved with the PNP development, which has its own really neat features too, which will, it sounds like, should be pretty unique to Theleston as a game style when it comes out. I know we're kind of getting close on the hour, but, you know, you might want to touch on some of those because they're pretty cool.
Yeah,
and we actually start a little bit late, so if you folks don't mind, we could, you know, probably go over a little bit. It doesn't have to end at the 1 hour mark here, but yeah, they're just, in terms of what's going on with the PNP, right now we've got the quick create basically done. In fact, I believe Snipe has been doing those parts of the character creator on the Thursday streams. Has been going pretty well. So the quick create is basically, instead of the origin matrix, which is the true legit way to create the character, that you're going through the, you know, what made the character who they are up to the point where you start playing them, and it isn't just, you know, pick a class, pick skills, you know, distribute attributes and go sort of thing, but you're really building the story of your character before you even actually play the character. That's the part that's so amazing about the Origin Matrix. But maybe you don't have the time for that. Maybe you've just got, you know, a few people you want to get playing the game. You've been talking about it all week. You finally brought the books. It's lunchtime or whatever. You've got your, you know, a few sets of dice. You got your character sheets. It's like, all right, we're just going to make some characters and get going with it. That's what we've got right now, the quick create. So it's definitely meant to be kept within the relative balance of the origin matrix, that you're not going to be able to make necessarily a more powerful character. One could definitely make the point that Quick Create gives the opportunity to min-max more than the origin matrix would, but there's definitely ways that that can be kept in check. Mostly the GM saying, hey, whoa, dude, you don't need to start with 8 strength, trust me. Like, let's put those attribute points elsewhere and not have your character start as a complete, like, brainless doofus with no grace that just happens to hit hard and, you know, can take a big punch to the face. So, you know, that's the sort of thing that I'm really excited to see with it, is what the origin matrix, and that's something I've been poking at. It's been kind of slow going, but I had put one version out that I was kind of working on and realized it was going to be too complex for really any use. So I kind of pulled back on that idea, and you know, that's how it is with me sometimes. I'll go overboard and then have to pull
sometimes
it back. Always.
Well, and Quick Create is cool too, because it's going to be a potentially really neat way for to get players trying it. You know, they don't have to spend a ton of time to jump into this, you know, to give it a try at a con, at a game store, you know, with friends, things like that. It'll be a nice way to go in, have an adventure, have some fun, and really buy into that, you know, world, I think, without having to read through the entire kind of core book just to get your footing.
Well, and these are intended to be apps, right? So you just pull them up on your phone?
So I just found out, I'm going to link this right now if I have permissions in the chat. Just last week, I came across D&D actually doing an official partnership with Roll20, which is supposed to help PNP online, so you can play like a PNP tabletop version of a variety of games, I guess, online. And I had not even thought about Theleston being played that way, but people should think about that. We can take the rest of that offline, but that would be interesting to,
you know, it's something that's definitely
really
thought about, but I think one of the things that makes the pen and paper so powerful is that you actually don't need to represent everybody in a physical space, and might actually better for the flow of things to not do that, to not have like, okay, I'm 3 hexes away from that guy, I'm going to move and then take an extra action for a half step lunge to make sure that I can just barely hit him with the tip of my thing. It's like, yeah, that's boring. Then you're playing the rules of the game rather than, you know, getting into it. It's like, oh, you know, you've got this guy in front of you and he's holding a mace over his hand and he's, you know, running at you menacingly. What are you going to do? And so, you know, based on who your character is, how they would interact in that situation, you take an action. Maybe your character's a pacifist. Maybe lunging with a spear or a saber or something is entirely out of character, and the thing they would do is try to duck out of the way and grab some sand to throw in their eyes or something and then run away. You know, that's the sort of thing that I think the pen and paper really lends itself to, is the ability to get out of some of the mindset and some of the rigidness of a what I would say is a tournament style pen and paper system like D&D or White Wolf, and instead something that is definitely a little bit more role play heavy, where you know, you might not necessarily even need to roll the dice in some situations. You've explained the thing that you want to do, and it's the right thing. And the DM or GM decides, okay, you know, they're coming at you in this way. You raised your shield in the exact right way. You know, you totally blocked it and knocked them off guard. You know, don't even need to roll on it. It's, you know, some of the times I feel like rolling in, you know, D&D and those sorts of games is just to make sure that you can fail, even if it's something that you totally should proficiently be able to succeed at. So I think that's one of the reasons why, while Roll20 definitely would have some advantages and would be able to get people playing and, you know, quicken up some of the use of the rules at the same time, that would require all the rules to be, you know, the rules and the interactions to be kind of built up in such a rigid way that you would actually need to use Roll20 to apply it to begin with. So it's definitely an interesting sort of thing. You know, it could really be done either way, but if you go with more of a Roll20 system, I just worry that it may or may not be flexible enough to really support, you know, what the actual gameplay in, you know, a live session in a living room or something would be like.
I think the key would be having the maps versus even having the dice, just because you have the option of using the dice doesn't mean that you have to use the dice. But what I like about what I've seen, the little I've seen of the Roll20 site, is that you can actually look at the maps and get an idea of what the environment looks like, and get a feel of where characters are supposed to be, and that does actually help with visualization for some people.
Yeah.
No, that's just interesting. I mean, you might be able to Snipe and Ombla might be able to make their own version of that for however that would look visually. But I'm just saying, an online version versus a literal pen and paper version might be interesting and something I had not thought of before.
You know, you actually brought up something that's been mentioned. I don't know if it's been formalized into an official project or if it's just something that's kind of on the fringes, but the idea of a companion app to the game that pretty much has the storytelling that's going on for what's going on in the world, what events are going on at that specific point in time. So that way, if you're doing campaigns with your buddies, you could have two or three different groups that you're doing campaigns with, but they could all be relatively in the same world with similar events going on. And the real power, the real magic to that is when it actually gets to the point where you're going to start seeing the pen and paper showing up at conventions and people actually playing it in real life, in real time at these conventions. All of the events that have gone on that they've participated in, they'll be able to share stories about it. If they had two players had campaigns going on in Crown's Rock at the same time, and the companion app is being used, the Chronicle, I think Ombal called it there.
The Chronicle, yeah. And a collaborative storytelling experience is our tagline for the PNP, and a sort of narrative rules ethos is why.
Narrative.
Yeah, it's sort of like a god's eye view of Theleston that progresses in real time and stuff.
Yeah. So that's going to be pretty awesome. The fact that all of the existing campaigns and what everybody's doing, and you know, if you've taken a physical break in game and you're coming back to it, you can come back to a point where the world has changed, history has, you know, happened, things are going on, and that really creates more of that meow environment, that multiplayer evolving world, and you know, so I just mentioned it in chat there, then, you know, even MMOs, like full graphical MMOs, can even get close to. They don't even want to try to do something like this. So the fact that, you know, this pen and paper project is going to have the you know, the ability for people widespread to kind of exist in the same world at the same time is just absolutely amazing, and it's I think something that really takes the genre forward in a pretty big way.
Yeah.
All right. So
I'm gonna dive in real quick and just say I love how when I mentioned Roll20, what I was actually envisioning is the maps and where people are on the map, just in terms of exploration, because I'm an explorer, I like where people are, and you immediately brought it to combat Nero, which, of course, I wasn't even thinking about combat because I really don't care
you
about
wouldn't.
Combat.
Speaking of maps, just to say, real quick, to shamelessly plug, patrons are getting really cool stuff right now in the form that Omba is inking out by hand a Theleston map. So.
Oh, cool. Maybe those pieces of those maps should be some hidden objects.
Ooh, that's a good idea. Indeed. So yeah, not to jump straight ahead, but yeah, the patron link that Rose just put out there. No matter how you look at it, right? You know, Theleston needs funding to some degree or another, and while these guys are definitely plugging away no matter what, these things help them build other assets and bring in outside talent and things like that. So, one of the things that you get with access as a patron is some of these inside lore drops and things you're doing. Pole has something that's been pretty awesome she's gotten. And all of us that are patrons here, we're getting to see our first real map of Theleston. Some of you remember Eversor made a map to kind of best guesses of what we'd known. Well, now we're going to get to see the real deal, you know, as it is and properly scaled.
Yeah, I want to make sure that folks know that where things are happening is not just Discord, but there's a whole new website for Theleston, and founders of Revival will have founder access on the Theleston website. So, you know, hit us up, let us know. I am checking that website, you know, at least 4 or 5 times a week to make sure that new members get founder access if they need it. But, you know, things are happening, and they're happening in places that are not apparent if you're only looking out on the Revival site.
Yes.
Yeah, so if you're not in chat here and you're not watching the replay on Twitch, it's a two-step link. First, you go to patreon.com/skywardstar to become a patron, and then you go to patrons.skywardstar.com to access that content. It's pretty cool. The Patreon, that's definitely been going well, and, you know, glad to see that, and definitely excited to see how it continues to progress and how the content from it starts to come through, especially the map that Omboa is drafting. That should be quite exciting. Definitely get to see that being done in that traditional style. That's pretty sweet.
Definitely. And Polaris got one of the first cool stuffs.
Nice.
Which is a box created by the lore god with items inside it, but the box is full of lore hints, and you can check that out on the Theleston website if you have a founder or patron status.
Yes.
Nice. So I mentioned it earlier, there's the fireside chats generally every Tuesday at
2:30 p.m.
Yeah, 2:30 Pacific, 3:30 what are they, Mountain Time? Or 5:30 Eastern. Definitely tune into that. And, you know, whatever time you are in the world, you know where to find it at least now. They cover a lot of stuff, what's been going on in the past week, what they've been working on. They take questions. If you have any questions about anything, that's a good time to ask.
But they aren't moving those over to YouTube. You aren't actually moving those over to YouTube. I don't see the fireside chats on YouTube usually when I look for them.
That's a miss, I think. Okay. So we'll have to make sure that happens.
Yeah.
Yep.
You can still review them on Twitch, though.
Yeah. Well, if they've been highlighted, they otherwise go away after 14 days.
Right. So we need to get them moved.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right.
They are at Skyward Star.
On the YouTube. Well,
then. Oh, Skyward Star instead of Dop Crew. Okay.
DOP Crew. Yeah. No, that makes sense.
So I'm just going to complain that there are way too many channels to follow everything. some of which you can have access to and or not. There's just way too many channels.
I think that's a valid point, actually. But I don't know how to solve it.
I don't know how to solve it either. I'm just tossing it out there.
I got to say, I don't think I saw any particular question during the show. Oh, I should also bring up, once again, the Thursday nights are usually the coding hour or coding show. Whatever Snipe's doing. Usually something related to character creator right now, but I'm not sure exactly which one he's on at the moment. But that starts at, I want to say 10:30 Mountain Time, 9:30 Pacific.
Sounds right.
I'm usually streaming during that, so I missed the first 30 minutes anyway and just passed that host along. So, but yeah, definitely tune into that. Again, that's a good place if you're interested in watching the development and seeing how it goes. Be there. Definitely be there. So, did anybody see any particular questions in chat? I can't really think of any that I saw.
I didn't see anything come across, with them once I kind of fill in the details as we went, I didn't see any questions come up.
So, are we starting to wrap up?
Yeah, I think so. If there's anything anybody wants to say, in fact, Diggs, it sounds like you're ready to go, so why don't you get started?
Well, I have a question, actually.
What you got?
What's our schedule plan? Are we planning to go every week? Do we have enough to go every week? Are we going to do twice a month? What's the schedule for this podcast?
That is a great question.
That's a great question.
At the moment, I think we've been looking at doing every other week just to make sure that we have enough time in between if people need to do stuff. It gives us a lot more room. If the amount of content and viewership and everything picks up to the point where we need to start doing it weekly, we can definitely start doing it weekly. But it's just, you know, getting something going so we can kind of cover what's been going on in the past couple of weeks and expand on a few things and have some guests on to talk about some stuff. So should be at least,
you know,
at least
what?
Every other week.
We haven't ever had Verde on.
You're right.
That's a good point. Yeah. Well, when he's back from stabbing people, we'll have to look at getting him on.
Yeah. Yeah, I've been meaning to chat with him about the combat system stuff anyway, so what better place than do it live?
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, let's start thinking about wrapping it up then. So, Diggs, I'll still have you start us off here. Any final thoughts or anything you want to share before we go here?
Not really. Join us back in 2 weeks for the next episode of Revival Cast, and we will try to have some interesting tidbits lined up for you and maybe a guest. That's about it.
Very cool. Zero, how about you?
Be excited to see everyone again in a couple weeks. In the meantime, check out the link drops that Rose's been dropping in there. Yes, there are a lot of different links to look at. They're all worthwhile, however. I assume the vast majority of people watching probably already know them. But
no, I don't know them, so...
Is that in the majority? Not everyone. So, you know, check it out. There is a lot of cool stuff. And if you're just tuning back in for the first time, having gone kind of away from keyboard for a lot of the development that's been happening over the past few months, so now's a good time to come back, you know, and check it out. A lot of things have happened. Some cool stuff.
Yeah.
All right, Paul, why don't you let us know what's going on with you?
I think the thing that I really want to kind of communicate is that the day after Snipe's post on the Revival forums dropped, I think it was 36 hours later, 24, 48, something like that, but it was within 2 days we had a new plan. And for all the folks out there who were bummed, just like I was, just like all of us were. Life has gone on. We've got new things happening. There are things to be enthused about. There's way to support. I mean, there's so much volunteer opportunity to get your hands into developing this project in ways that can make things happen. And it's, geez, you know, I get it that a lot of people out there that you didn't know that you missed it, that you left the revival forums maybe and didn't come back till now. But damn, there's stuff happening. You know? Come on down. Because there is so much stuff. It is so cool. You know? Artists, coders, idea people, money people. I mean, there's artists. Just room for everybody.
And artists.
I said artists. Yes.
I sang it three times.
But yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, the excitement and the enthusiasm can be really palpable. And it carries all of us day to day. And gosh, if you missed it, come on down.
Absolutely. And for me, I'm just glad to see a talk show that isn't something being done by the developers finally being done again, because I was kind of missing that, I'll be honest with you. So glad to be back, everybody, and glad to have you all back, and everybody in chat. Really appreciate all of you folks coming, everybody watching this on Twitch or on YouTube after the show here. Thanks again. Hope you get to tune in for the next one in a couple weeks. And on that, it is time to wrap up. See you later.
Thanks, guys.